Our first guest this morning is the president and CEO of one of the leading conglomerates here in the Philippines, Filinvest Development Corp's Josephine Gotianun-Yap. Thrilled to have you with us this morning, Joji. Thank you for joining us.
Good morning, Michelle.
Okay, so Joji, we're about 1 year and 3 months out from the pandemic, and we're all trying to figure out what we've actually learned from all of this, specifically what happened to our economy. When you look at our growth and high frequency indicators, how they've collapsed and struggled, what surprised you? I'm very curious, what surprised you the most about this economy over the last year? And looking back, would you have expected the economy to be where it is today?
Well, there are certain areas of the economy which have been quite resilient. And this is the office leasing segment that caters to the multinational BPOs. And as well as, surprisingly, the residential property business as well has been able to have a V-shaped recovery. We're starting to see 2021 sales levels starting to go up towards pre-pandemic levels. So there are certain areas in our economy that have done well. A lot of the banking sector, our East West banking subsidiary still delivers among the highest return on equities as well.
But when you look at the broader business environment, are you more optimistic for the next perhaps 8 to 12 months?
Yes, definitely. I think we will still end the year with a positive growth despite the contraction first quarter and possibly the second quarter. I believe our economic managers share the same view. They're predicting a 6% growth. And the multilateral agencies like IMF and ABB are also looking at an upper 4% growth range. We expect that the vaccine rollout in NCR plus, the traditional higher Christmas spending, and possibly election-related spending coming in, we should have a stronger second half. Economic frontliners are also now undergoing vaccines, so that should contribute to higher business activity as well as improve consumer spending and confidence.
Joji, from the health perspective, when you look at what is happening from your perspective on the national level, the rolling lockdowns that we've just seen, the vaccination program, which is starting to ramp up, is there anything you think that the national government can replicate from how the private sector is doing its business? You know, they always say, you want to get things done, get the private sector to do it.
Well, I think one of the things that has happened in the COVID is that the private sector helped the government a lot as well in all of these initiatives. So there were many initiatives in the beginning, such as the ramping up of the testing capacity and even vaccination rollout are done hand in hand with the private sector. And I think without that, the government would have had a much more difficult time. Given their procurement policy, it was very difficult for them to really ramp up. And so the sector was able to come in.
Let's look at the major units of your business, of Filinvest. When you look at the recovery trajectory of the businesses under Filinvest Development Corp, you've got property. You briefly mentioned this earlier, the banking services, your infrastructure, sugar and power. When you look at the trajectory of each unit, what does it say about the recovery we're seeing? It seems like financials will be the first to recover if basing on the first quarter results. For the laggards, though, how long do you think they will need to catch up?
Well, luckily, FDC performed relatively well in 2020. Mm-hmm. We emerged among the top 10 conglomerates in terms of profitability. We were top 6 to be exact. And that is really because of the diversification strategy we adopted, which is a balanced mix of cyclical and defensive businesses. So we can see that in the property business, the most resilient is office leasing. And on the hospitality sector, they continue to be the most affected. However, we're already seeing them climb from the trough, and occupancies are now reaching 30 to 50% when they used to be zero at the height of the pandemic. So we're expecting probably a return in the first early 2023 when international travel normalizes. As I mentioned earlier, we're seeing residential sales starting to accelerate towards pre-pandemic levels. And I believe that's because the public and the sellers have adjusted to digital marketing and minimal physical contact sales processes. In Mindanao, the increase in 2021 was just around 2%. So we'll have to wait for business activity to improve for that to improve.
I wanted to talk about the unusual suspects, Joji. When you talk about Filinvest Development, these are not the usual units that people cite. I wanted to cite two businesses that have so far been under the radar, at least not getting the same attention as the bigger units. You've got your sugar business and your infrastructure push. Your sugar business, you've got three Mindanao-based sugar companies that do milling, refining, developing sugarcane farms. How's that side of the business and the environment in Mindanao? You briefly talked about Mindanao.
Well, the sugar business is a very small part of our business, but it is a very resilient part of our business. I always tell people that sugar was really the one that helped us during the Asian crisis. And so it's like any of the food basic essentials. It continues to have a demand during even pandemic times, right? Mm-hmm. So and in the infrastructure, we're continuing our commitment to finish the international airport of Clark. However, I think one of the businesses that people don't know as much is that we have built up an eco-sustainable platform. And this is mainly 5 years ago, we started to do things like district cooling, and we're in partnership with NG for solar rooftop systems, as well as renewable energy, solar farming. And we also tied up with Hitachi Aquatech to do sustainable water. And this includes recycled water, desalination, and sewage treatment. So we're doing a lot of these environment sustainable solutions.
And Joji, you mentioned it's not something that many people know. When do you expect this side of the business to, you know, account for a bigger chunk of your top line or bottom line?
Most of the investments will be going in the next 2 years. So I think that should come in. That should come in around that time. So we are pursuing about 56 megawatts as well in solar farms. So I believe that maybe in about after 2 years, that should start coming into the picture.
Mm-hmm. Since we're on the topic of sustainability, ESG, how do you think COVID-19 has changed your ESG strategy?
COVID per se, I believe, wasn't the catalyst to our environmental strategy. As I mentioned earlier, as far back as 5 years ago, we already started investing in green businesses for what environment sustainable initiatives. So I mentioned our partnerships with NG, Hitachi. But the other thing as well is FDC's vision has always been to empower Filipinos to attain their dreams. So we've always focused on the underserved market. And our social sustainability goal is financial inclusion. So for example, East West Bank recently launched COMO, the first exclusively digital banking service granted by the DSP to a local universal bank. And this increases our reach to the unbanked market. And on the innovation front, FDEV, our digital arm, as well launched Investree Philippines. We received the first funding license from the SEC for a digital platform to finance small and medium enterprises. Again, another incentive towards greater inclusion. And lastly, we believe that Phil REIT will be an excellent addition to the REIT, the growing REIT market. Phil REIT's portfolio is composed mainly of grade A offices with multinational BPO tenants. And REIT reaches, this REIT will allow a wider audience to have a chance to participate in the rental income streams derived from the BPO and e-commerce space, one of the most resilient segments in the industry.
You mentioned how you want to help Filipinos attain their dreams. Let's talk about the dream to travel. because you have this project you mentioned as well earlier, your North Luzon Airport Consortium. When do you realistically expect things to take off from the Clark International Airport? And I guess the more important question on everyone's minds now is how much business do you think Ramon Angs Bulacan Airport project will take from your airport?
Well, I think initially we will be coming in, of course, much earlier, while the Bulacan Airport will take a little bit more time. And hopefully that by that time, the travel numbers or travel traffic will have gone up by then so that there should be enough business for everyone. We do have as well a very large catchment area because we do have the North Luzon and the Central Luzon catchment.
Mm-hmm. Okay, let's talk about CapEx. I know you've earmarked some 21.2 billion pesos for CapEx this year. That's higher, that's lower than 2020's 25.7. But really, so far from 2019's 39 billion, I remember in 2018, you were at 45 billion within that neighborhood. When do you see CapEx returning to pre-COVID levels? And are you seeing any need to restructure obligations, sell assets, return to the stock market to raise funds, aside from the REIT IPO that you're planning, of course?
So we don't see any major fundraising activities at the FDC level. The balance sheet is healthy and has a net debt to equity of 0.4:1. So last year, we already raised $200 million in September, and that should be ample purchase for us. Most of our projects are already lined up, ready to go. So we are just putting our ears on the ground to make sure that we launch them when we feel the market is strong enough. So they're there, they're ready to go. And we have lined up as well our financing requirements so that when the market picks up, we can easily bring them into the market. So I think the major fundraising activity really is the Filinvest REIT Corp, and we have filed a registration statement for a REIT IPO with the SEC in March, and we are targeting for a third quarter listing this year at the PSE. And it's quite exciting because we have handpicked 17 grade A buildings for the quality and the diversity of its tenancy. Over 300,000 square meters of principally office space, mostly located in the 18 hectare Northgate Cyber Zone, Epeza Zone in Filinvest, and the tower in Cebu Cyber Zone, also PEZA registered economic zone. These multinational BPO companies account for about 88.4% of the occupied gross leasable area of our planned REIT portfolio. So the POGO tenants occupy only a very small 2.8%, and the remainder of 10% is between the traditional non-BPO offices and a few retail offices. So,
go ahead.
The last major fundraising would be FLI. They'll do the second tranche of their bond offering. So last November 2020, they successfully raised 8 billion pesos with the highest fill rates rating of PRS AAA retail bonds.
Joji, you sound very optimistic. I'm getting a sense that you're really very bullish about the recovery story. Is there anything that you're worried about, economically speaking? What keeps you up at night?
I'm always a cautiously optimistic person. I think the pandemic was really a curveball. And we survived the pandemic. And we survived it relatively well. So I don't think anything can beat the pandemic, because the pandemic is a worldwide problem. It's health, economics, etc. So if I can live through the pandemic, nothing should keep me awake at night, right?
Wow. Okay. That's a great point to end in, but I wanted to just insert one more question. Forward looking, Joji, they say crises like this one are perfect opportunities. Perfect opportunities for what? Are you seeing anything that interests you in the M&A space?
Yes, we're always on the lookout for M&A, and we're always hoping that we can get acquisitions at better prices. It's not always the case. Some people still have not adjusted to the system, and they're still asking for high prices, right? But what we have done is we've focused instead on like-minded partnerships to grow our business, like our partnership with NG, Hitachi, Mitsubishi, Changi, so that we can go ahead and explore new areas of growth.
Okay. On that note, Joji, thank you so much for joining us this morning. It was a pleasure to finally have you on the show. Stay safe, ma'am. See you soon.
Well, thank you.